If you have a Bible on, they might want to turn with me today to Mark chapter 14. Mark 14. I want to welcome you back to week number two of a series that we began last week called Dangerous Prayers. This series is a series in which I'm introducing you to some prayers that are not your typical, ordinary prayers. You know, most of our typical prayers are pretty generic and predictable and safe. Prayers like this: God be with me, God protect me, God bless me. Now, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with those kind of prayers. There's nothing wrong with those prayers at all. I'm simply saying that they are safe prayers. They are not the kind of prayers that will ever move us out of our comfort zone and stretch our faith. But the prayers that we're looking at in this series, they're very specific, they're unpredictable, they're dangerous, but they're dangerous in a good way. They're the kind of prayers that have the potential to challenge us. They're the kind of prayers that have the potential to change the course of our life, to conform us more into the image and likeness of Jesus Christ. Last week, we got the series going by looking at this dangerous prayer: search me. And if you prayed that prayer this week, if you, before you got out of bed, you began to say to God, search me, I would say that there were some things that God revealed to you, some things that maybe you believed to be true about your life that maybe weren't true, because as we saw last week, the heart is deceitful. The heart will try to convince us and get us to believe things that aren't true. And so if you prayed that prayer, search me, I know that the Holy Spirit did a work in your life this week. Well, today, we're going to move on, and we're going to look at this dangerous prayer: break me. I want you to look, if you would, at Mark chapter 14, beginning in verse number 1. Let's see what Mark writes. It says, "Now the Passover and unleavened bread were 2 days away. And the chief priests and the scribes were seeking how to seize him by stealth and kill him. For they were saying, not during the festival, otherwise there might be a riot of the people. While he was in Bethany, at the home of Simon the leper, and reclining at the table, there came a woman with an alabaster vial or an alabaster jar, a very costly perfume of pure nard. And she broke the vial and poured it over his head." Father, speak to our hearts. May we receive your word today as truth. Holy Spirit, we just ask that you would teach us, that you would make application, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, one of the places that Jesus liked to visit when he was on this earth, especially when he was in the vicinity of Jerusalem, was a town that was located about a mile and a half to the east of Jerusalem called Bethany. It was in Bethany where Jesus raised from the dead one of his dearest friends, Lazarus. You remember that story? That's where it happened. It was in Bethany. In fact, when Jesus and the disciples came to Bethany, they usually hung out with Lazarus and his sisters, Mary and Martha. And so Bethany held a very, very special place in the heart of Jesus. And the reason that it held such a special place in the heart of Jesus is because of the special people that lived there. If you think about the places that are special to you, the places that you like to go, so often it's not necessarily because of the place itself, it's because of the people that are there. You know why I like home? It's not because of the house. You know why I like home? I like home because of the special people that I find there. My wife and my children. Do you want to know why I like North Dixon Baptist Church? It's not because of this building. It's because of the people that are here. That's what makes this place special. And so Bethany was a very special place to Jesus because of the special people that lived there. And so it really is no surprise that just days before Jesus would enter Jerusalem for the final time before being crucified, that we find him here in this special place where there were so many special people. Now, this was a sweet spot for Jesus. This was a place of love for Jesus, as we're going to see. This time we find Jesus in the home of a man named Simon the leper. He's not at the home of Lazarus and Mary and Martha. He's at Simon the leper's home. And Mark doesn't tell us the reason why Jesus is at Simon the leper's home, but John does. John tells us in John chapter 12, verse 2, that a dinner is being given in Jesus' honor. Now, my guess, and again, this is just simply a guess on my part, a speculation on my part, but at some point, I believe that Jesus had healed Simon of leprosy. And so Simon, he wanted to honor Jesus for what he had done for him. And I think it's very interesting that while Simon had lost his leprosy, he never lost his name. Have you ever thought about that? Because we know that if Simon still had leprosy, he would not have been in Bethany. Where would he have been? He would have been in a leper's colony. Yet here we find him in Bethany, and he's known as Simon the leper, even though he's been healed of his leprosy. I think that's very interesting, that he's still known as Simon the leper. Now, I don't know why that is. I don't know why he was still known as Simon the leper. Maybe it's because he never wanted to forget the cleansing power of Jesus Christ in his life. Maybe he said, you know what? I want to be known as Simon the leper because I never want to forget what Jesus Christ did for me when he cleansed me of my leprosy. I don't know. But what I know is that Simon threw a party to honor Jesus. What I do know is that while Jesus is reclining at the table, a woman comes up to Jesus with an alabaster jar or a vial of perfume that was made of pure nard. And I want to emphasize it was pure nard and not pure lard, all right? Now, the nard that Mark refers to was what there was an oil that was extracted from a root that was primarily found in India. So it was a very rare type of perfume. And when something is very rare, it is usually very what? It's usually very expensive. Now, just how expensive was this perfume? Well, a jar of this stuff would have cost the equivalent of a year's wages, or about 300 denarii. And so this was the kind of perfume that, I mean, this was not the kind of perfume that you would put on every day. This was the kind of perfume that you would only wear, that you would only put on for a special occasion. How many of you have some perfume like that? Nobody has that kind of perfume. Okay, guys. How many guys have that type of cologne? How many guys wear cologne? Praise the Lord. All right. We will make it a matter of prayer. All right? Well, this woman, she had this perfume, and it was very rare, and so she didn't wear it every day. It was something that she would only wear, put on, for those special occasions in life. And so you can imagine, I mean, just picture the scene. Here Jesus, the disciples, they're reclining at this table. This woman comes up. She breaks open this jar of rare, expensive perfume, and she begins to pour the perfume on Jesus. Imagine the surprise of everyone there when this woman begins pouring out on Jesus' head this expensive perfume. Mark 14, verse 3 says, "And while he was in Bethany at the home of Simon the leper, and reclining at the table, there came a woman with an alabaster vial of costly perfume of pure nard, and she broke the vial and poured it over his head." She broke and she poured. She broke and she poured. I want you to say that with me. She broke and she poured. You got that picture in your head? She broke it and she poured it on Jesus. What an extravagant act of worship. Now, in breaking open this vial or this jar and pouring out all the perfume on Jesus, you know what this woman was saying to Jesus? She was saying, "My life is yours. My life is yours. This perfume, it represents the most valuable thing I possess. In essence, it represents my life. And I'm pouring it all out as a love offering for you." Now, earlier, I mentioned that this kind of perfume was a perfume that you wore only on special occasions, so that it would last your entire life. And so for this woman, this was a special occasion. It was her giving her entire life to the one who in just a few days would give his entire life for her. She broke and she poured, all out of love for her Lord. Now, for just a second or more, I want to transition from this table moment to another table moment. If you were to look down just a few verses in Mark chapter 14, we find Jesus once again reclining at a table. This time, it is in Jerusalem. It's in an upper room. Gathered around this table are Jesus and his 12 disciples. It's going to be the Last Supper he shares with them before his death on the cross. I want you to look and see what Mark says, beginning in verse 22. It says, "And while they were eating, he took some bread, and after a blessing, he broke it and gave it to them. And he said, 'Take it. This is my body.'" Mark continues in verses 23 and 24. "And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it." How many of you are glad that we no longer observe communion that way? Huh? Aren't you glad we have the little cups? The germaphobes would never participate in communion, right? Amen. So we can be glad that we have these little cups now that we can drink juice from. But back then, they took one cup, they passed it around, and they all drank from it. Jesus said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is to be shed on behalf of many. This is my blood of the covenant, which is shed, which is poured out for many." Broken and what? Broken and poured out. Broken and poured out. Jesus says, "My body will be broken for you. My blood will be poured out for you." This bread and this wine, they represent the most valuable thing that I possess, my life, and I'm going to pour it all out for you on the cross. After Jesus had finished saying this, Luke tells us in chapter 22, verse 19, that Jesus continued with these words. He said, "Do this in remembrance of me." Do this in remembrance of me. Do what? What's Jesus talking about? Well, I think Jesus obviously was saying that we should take bread, that we should take wine or juice, just as he did with the disciples, and remember that what they symbolically represent. His body broken, his blood poured out for our salvation. In other words, Jesus is saying that we should do what we call communion, what we call Lord's Supper. And so all scholars agree this is what Jesus was saying when he said, "Do this in remembrance of me." Now, what's interesting is that there are some scholars that suggest that Jesus had more in mind. Yes, it was a command to us that we were to observe the Lord's Supper, that we were to take the bread, to take the juice, and symbolically represent Jesus' sacrifice for us on the cross. That's one thing. But some scholars also believe that Jesus was also saying that just as he was broken, just as he was poured out for us, that we should be broken, that we should be poured out for him. Do this in remembrance of me. Just as I was broken, just as I was poured out for you, I want you to do something for me. In remembrance of what I've done for you, I want you to be broken, and I want your life to be poured out for me. Some believe that Jesus was saying that, in fact, one of the best ways that we can remember what he did for us is to do this ourselves. Jesus was broken. He was poured out once on the cross for us. And Jesus says that he wants us to be broken and poured out daily on the cross for him. You know what Jesus said in Luke chapter 9? There were large crowds that were beginning to follow Jesus. I mean, everybody really wanted to be around Jesus because of what he was doing. And it was just something that people wanted. They wanted to follow Jesus. But Jesus then turns to the crowd and he says something to them. He says in Luke chapter 9, beginning of verse 23, he says, if anyone wishes to come after me, if anyone wishes to follow me, let him what? Deny himself, take up his what? Cross. Now again, what did a cross represent? What did a cross represent for Jesus? It was a place of what? Sacrifice, a place of death. Jesus says, if anyone wants to follow me, he must deny himself. He needs to take up his cross, just as Jesus did, and follow me. Jesus says, this is something we're going to do daily. For whoever wishes to save his life shall lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake, he is the one who will save. See, when we hold on to our life, we will never find Jesus' life. It's only as we lose our life. It's only as we die to self daily. You know why we have to die to self daily? Because daily, self wants to rise up and make control. Have you ever noticed that? Wouldn't it be great if it was just a one-time thing? I mean, is it the flesh? I mean, it was just taken care of once and for all. But every single day, I don't know about you, but every single day of my life, there's a struggle that goes on. The flesh wants to rise up and it wants to take control, but I can die. I can deny self. I can die to self, and I can allow the Holy Spirit, by his power, to fill me so that I can live for Jesus Christ, so that my life can be an offering to him. So God wants us to lose our life so that we can find true life. I want you to hear this today. We can never love like Jesus loves, serve like Jesus serves, or live like Jesus lives until we first die like Jesus died. You want to serve God every day? You want to love the way that he loves? You want to live like that Jesus lives? You got to die. You got to die like Jesus died. Broken and poured out. Broken and poured out. Every single day, broken and poured out. Paul wrote this in Galatians 2:20. He says, I have been crucified with Christ. And it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, how's he living? I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and delivered himself, or gave himself up for me. Paul said Christ lives in me. I mean, don't you want that to be your daily testimony? Don't you want to be able to say Christ lives in me? Now, how did Christ live in Paul? How can Christ live in us? There's only one way. Only one way. And that is by death. It's by death. I no longer live because I have been crucified with Christ, Paul says. Broken and poured out. When I dies in us, Christ lives in us. So maybe you've heard it said, and I wish, you know, it kind of hit me. I'm not a carpenter at all, but if I would have been thinking about it, I would have brought two pieces of wood and I would have made a cross. You know, you've heard it said that the cross is I crossed out or marked out, right? I no longer live. Why? Because I've been crucified with Christ. And so Paul says, I don't live because I've been crucified with Christ. When I dies in us, Christ lives in us, broken and poured out. And here's what I want you to hear today, church. Brokenness results in usefulness. Brokenness results in usefulness. Do you remember what Peter told Jesus he would never do? You remember that story? I mean, there's so many things to admire about Peter. I think Peter, I mean, he intended, I mean, he meant well. But sometimes he got ahead of himself. And sometimes he would say things and he wouldn't follow through. You ever have that problem? Peter had that problem. Peter told Jesus that he would never deny it. In Mark chapter 14, verse 31, the Bible says Peter kept saying insistently. I mean, so this wasn't just one time. I mean, Peter has kept on insisting over and over again. He said, even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you. It's just never going to happen. I will be crucified. I will die with you. There's no way that I would ever deny your name. Well, if you know the rest of the story, did you know Peter ends up doing exactly what he said he would what? Never do. And the reason Peter disowned Jesus is because I was still alive in Peter. I was still alive. But after Jesus was crucified, Peter became a different person. You look at Peter in Mark chapter 14, and then you look at Peter in the book of Acts, and you see two different men. What was the difference? I had died in Peter. The man that deserted Jesus before the cross became a man that defended Jesus after the cross. You read Acts chapter 2 and you will see Peter being used by God in an amazing way. What changed? I no longer live in Peter. I had been crucified with Christ, and as a result, Christ lived in Peter, broken and poured out, and that brokenness resulted in usefulness. See, if we want to be used by God, we have to first be broken. Broken and poured out. And as we're broken and poured out, we become useful to the Lord Jesus Christ. See, Peter, he'd never been broken. He'd never been poured out. He said, I will do this. But then there came a day in his life where he was broken and he was poured out. And at that moment, he became useful to the Lord Jesus Christ. And if we want to be useful to the Lord Jesus Christ on a daily basis, we have to be broken. We have to be poured out. And that brings us back to Bethany. When this woman begins pouring out this expensive perfume on Jesus, there were some who began to say to one another, for what purpose has this perfume been wasted? Verse 4. Jesus says in verse 6, let her alone. Leave her alone. Why do you bother her? She has done a good deed. She has done a beautiful thing for me. I want you to hear something today very important. There are those that believe when you pour out your life for Jesus that you are wasting your life. But based on this story, that is simply not true. Life is never wasted that is poured out for Jesus Christ. The only life that is wasted is a life that is never poured out for Jesus Christ. Because a life that is never poured out for Jesus Christ is self-contained. And Jesus doesn't want us to live a self-contained life. Jesus wants us to live a life that is broken and poured out before Him so that He can use us. The life that is wasted is that life that is self-contained because it's never poured out. Jesus says there's beauty in brokenness. And then Jesus goes on to say this about this woman in verse 9. I love this. Wherever the gospel is preached in the whole world, the gospel is being preached today at North Mixon Baptist Church. And Jesus says, wherever the gospel is preached in the whole world, that also which this woman has done shall be spoken in memory or remembrance of her. Here we are, all these years later, and because this woman was willing to take her life and allow it to be broken and poured out for Jesus Christ, we remember. We remember her today. Listen, you want your life to be remembered?
Yeah.
Your life will be remembered as you are broken and poured out. You think about the people that you have known all throughout your life. Those people that you went to church with, those people as you were a kid that they were Sunday school teachers and deacons and people who served in the church, people that you remember. I want to say this. You probably remember them because they were people who lived their life broken and poured out. So if we want to be someone who's remembered, if we want our life to be a testimony of the love of God and the grace of God and the mercy of God, if we want our life to bring glory to God, we have to be broken and we have to be poured out. It's not a popular message to preach in our culture. In our culture, it's all about, if you follow Jesus, you won't suffer. If you follow Jesus, there's not going to be persecution. If you follow Jesus, life's going to be good. But listen, if you follow Jesus, you need to break your life. You need to pour it out. And listen, it'll be a beautiful thing in the world. Now, I'm closing. Okay, I'm bringing this to a close.
There you go.
A life poured out for Jesus will leave a lasting fragrance on this earth. Interesting, this has worked out well today. I wore cologne today, man. Put it on before I left. My wife said, this particular cologne that I have on today, it is what? Overwhelming, right? I mean, it's strong. Listen, when I left my bedroom, it left a fragrance. Have you ever had somebody walk into a room, they walk in, you smell, they leave, they're gone, and that fragrance still lingers? That should be our life. That should be our life test. Our fragrance, the fragrance of the Lord Jesus Christ, it should linger long after we have left this earth. That's what happened with this woman, and that's what God wants to happen in our life. Now, you remember the reason Simon the leper had this dinner? Remember? It was to what? Honor him. It was to honor Jesus. The greatest way we can honor Jesus is to give him the most valuable thing any of us possess, and that is our life. That's the way we can honor. And that's exactly what this woman did. She poured out her life to Jesus. So let me just ask you as we close today, do you want to honor Jesus? Do you want to honor Him? Well, let me just say this. If you want to honor Jesus, make your life a prayer through daily brokenness. Every day, go to Jesus, break open and pour out to him the most valuable thing you have, your life. Say to Jesus, my life is yours. My life is yours. I am pouring it all out as a love offering to you, just as you poured out your life as a love offering. Break me is a dangerous prayer, because a life broken before God is a life that God can work through to honor him in ways that will leave a lasting fragrance on this earth. I don't know about you, but I want the aroma of Jesus to be on my life in such a way that when I'm gone, that fragrance lingers on. And that's only going to happen when we're broken and we're poured out. That's an action of love. So I'm going to ask everybody bow their heads, everybody close their eyes. I want you to think about something for a moment. I want you to think about Simon. Simon was a leper. In the Bible, leprosy represented sin. Leprosy separated people from God. It separated them from others. But Jesus touched Simon, and he cleansed him. And here's what I want you to know today. Jesus wants to touch you, and he wants to cleanse you. Sin, it separates you from God. But just like he touched Simon the leper, he wants to touch you today. He wants to cleanse you of your sin. And so if you're here today and you've never trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior and your Lord, I want to invite you to make that decision today. Jesus Christ, he died on the cross. He was crucified. Why? Because of our sin. We've all sinned. We've all missed the mark. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. The wages of that sin is death. But Jesus Christ, he died in our place. And so today, would you trust in Jesus Christ as the way of salvation? If you've never made that decision, in just a few moments, we're going to have what we call an invitation time. And it's just simply a time for you to respond to God speaking to your heart. And if you're here today and you know that you've never trusted in Jesus Christ your Savior, I want to ask you to stand and to come down this aisle, take me by the hand and say, Pastor Travis, I want to trust Jesus Christ as my Savior and Lord. Maybe you're here and you just want to come to these altars. They're open. These altars are open. And maybe you want to say, Lord, I'm breaking my life before you. Broken and poured out. Broken and poured out. Broken. You just say that to Jesus. Here I am. Broken and poured out. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for this testimony of this woman who one day took what represented her entire life and she poured it out on you. And Jesus, may we live our life daily in such a way. May we be broken and may we be poured out. Father, may we leave a lasting fragrance because we have lived a life where we have broken and poured out our life before you. I pray for the one here today who's never trusted in you, who's never been cleansed by you. May they come. Give them the courage. Give them the strength to step out and walk this aisle in just a few moments. Holy Spirit, I just give this time to you. I just ask that you would work and move, that Jesus Christ may be lifted up and he might be glorified. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. If you'll stand as we sing, would you not wait? Would you come right now? Come to these altars. Pour out your life before Jesus. Thank you. You may be seated as we prepare for baptism. I believe you're going to have a song to sing.
Turning your hymnals to hymn number 515. We're going to sing When We All Get to Heaven. Church, this is Chuck, and Chuck has come today because he desires to follow the Lord in baptism. Chuck, have you trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord? Upon your profession of faith, it is my joy to baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.